Beautiful snowy day up here at Doe Mountain, back on the steed. I've been riding that race edition for like months, and it's great. It's an awesome bike. I love it, but I got well over 200 hours seat time on this bike, and I'm just so comfortable and used to the controls and the geometry and the predictability. I know exactly what this bike and suspension is going to do, no matter what kind of situation I'm in or what I put it through, because I've spent so much time on it. I'm out here with my buddy Dane Shoveling today. Yeah, bud. It's fucking awesome to be back on this bike, though. Can't see shit for the snow. My eyelashes are about frozen over. I should have threw some goggles on today. But this old girl's sitting about 302 hours. I've got a fresh Recluse rebuild in it. Did everything. I did the base, all the steels, clutch pads, flush fluid, new springs. There's also springs that go inside of the EXP base. It's literally a brand new clutch. I think I just got it dialed in the parking lot. I put a new clutch rod in it. The previous ride with 300 hours did have a little dimple from the slave bearing. There was a noticeable little crease in her, pretty deep. So instead of letting that baby split or get wore out, I went ahead and proactively replaced it. And definitely had to adjust my clutch grab because of that. It's much different than it was. So I was getting clutch like right here, and I was like, hell no, I want clutch like, you know, basically right here, just a finger flick, right? Like, that's full clutch right there. That's full release. That's what I wanted. You good, bud?
Yeah, I need my hair to
warm. It's cold, dude. It's cold. All right. Put them on that expansion chamber, buddy. But I had a friend of mine request that I talk more during my videos. And as you guys know, it's not always easy to talk and ride hard enduro. But I'm gonna try when we're out here on this main trail shit. And basically, I wanna talk setup a little bit. One of the questions that came from that same buddy were, what kind of tires you run, man? You run tubeless? You run bibs? You run tubes? What do you run? I run tubeless, front and rear. I like to start around 9 and 4, 9 and 5 pressures. About 9.5 in the front, no more than 10.5 for any conditions. Maybe a little less if necessary. And I'll start around about four in the back. 5 if I'm like, you know, hair scrambling. 6, 6.5 if I'm like road riding or doing some real fast stuff like Colorado or something. But nine and five or 10 and 4, 10 and 4, 9 and 5, anywhere in that range. And of course you can go down to zero with a tubeless. But I run a Shinko Fatty on the front. The I think it's a 716 or 726 is the number. Shinko fat tire. And I run a 505 in the rear pretty religiously. I'm getting ready to try the IRC Gakoda, the VE33S. I want to see how she does on my race edition. My plans are to make that my race bike once I get the suspension valved and freshen all the fluids. Kind of start that bike from fresh for the race season, maybe even put a little graphics on her or so. Make it officially mine. Because all I've done is resprung the rear suspension, did some oil filter oil change maintenance, or air filter oil change maintenance, just some very basic stuff, and just rode it. I would guess that bike's got 30-ish hours on it now. We'll see. I gotta get the dealer to hook their computer to it, because my odometer computer readout display has reset 3 times now. So Beta covered that under warranty. I already had the speed cable fixed. So hopefully I'm getting another new speedo cable. So I have 2 backup speedo cables. I'm sure that the first one, the very original, OEM, cable is bound to be dusted, but the one that's on there, I'm assuming it's fine, so I'm gonna keep it as a backup. Probably toss the original one, at least mark it as no good, and then from there that new computer should take care of my problems, I'm hoping. This bike is a fucking amazing. God, it's got so much torque and lug. And she just keeps freaking trucking, baby. Oh, snow clobber right in the eye. Probably need to wipe my eye out. It is definitely a cold ass winter day up here today. Dave and I are the only ones here. Not a vehicle in the parking lot. Just the dude managing and working today. I got some real sad news from the MTRA, the Mountain Trail Rider guys. Their president and fearless leader actually passed from COVID, which is terrible. Younger guy too, 30s, 40 maybe, I guess. And he passed from COVID complications. And that group were the ones responsible for putting on the Doe Mountain Race, the Sasquatch event. So I made myself available, told him I'd volunteer, do whatever I had to do to coordinate the event, work the event, help someone else do those two things, or get it set up, whatever the case may be, in order to have it continue and be available, because I know that there's guys showing interest. I had several of my buddies ask me if I knew anything about the Sasquatch 3, which would be this year's race. And a couple people tagged a few people that are pretty familiar with those operations. And I think the president-elect for the MTRA group will have a pretty good say in all that, as well as the Doe Mountain management folks, which are the guys here that I signed up with and kind of I didn't buy my pass here. You got to buy your pass online because of COVID. But just the old boy that manages the gate and tells you to show you his pass. That ground was completely frozen slick just now. I just gave her a little goose and about lost her. I lost her right from under me. Dane was like, bruh, it's gonna be terrible today. It's slicker and shit. It's better than I would have expected, I guess. I've been here when it's awful, and it's not awful. It's definitely wet and slick, but the ground's at least a little frozen, so it's kind of hard and compacted a bit. Not much, but a bit. I've been here in the rain, I've been here in the sun, I've been here in the snow, and I'll definitely say that the rain is definitely the worst, because when it's warm and it's wet, this ground, it's like chocolate cake, and it just, your tire just takes everything that's underneath of it away, and there's no traction there. You just dig a hole. You don't bite and go. You good? I think Dane was wanting me to stop.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so anyways, back to my story here. Bud's wanting to know more about my setup. I actually want to rewind a little bit. I know a lot of my buddies out there are, still on other bikes, YZs, not dedicated enduro, 300 cc two-stroke electric start bikes. Bros, you need to get one. A year ago, or whatever, prior to last November, before last November, I've been riding a Honda CRF 450X for a long time, few years. Rebuilt the bottom end on that bike when I first got it. I bought it from the previous owner with a busted side case, paid a very fucking not competent shop, very incapable shop back home in West Virginia that fucked me. And not even 20 hours later, nothing in there was set to torque specs. Nothing was Loctited holding things together that should have been. On top of that, fucking bolts were mismatched. Bolts were missing. They're in the wrong place. So I get 20 hours out of that bottom end. Bearings were fucking pressed in there sideways. I was getting fucking metal shavings in the oil. I just got purely fucked. I paid these guys good money. Wasn't a rush fucking job. And I got fucking screwed. And even everything that I'd asked for, when I got the bike back, like the one thing I was like, hey, please, 100% make sure the fucking e-start works. That's why I bought this bike. Well, they were supposed to fucking put a battery in it and, did whatever else the fucking thing needed. Because I just handed them money and said, here's enough to get you started, like $1,000 or more. And they're like, oh, thanks, man. Appreciate you making it easy on us. And I was like, yeah, well, thanks for taking care of me, because that's how fucking business relationships and they're a friend were supposedly a friend, too. So I didn't want him buying my parts out of pocket, not being able to fucking cover bills or going out to dinner or doing whatever the fuck life would have required, So I front him up some money without even being asked for it. And I was like, we'll square up at the end, whether you owe me money back, which I knew wasn't gonna be the case, or however much more that I owe you, we'll take care of it. Okay, cool. Well, a week goes by and I'm like, hey man, how's progress? He's like, oh well, haven't even ordered parts and haven't touched the bike. And I'm like, you motherfucker. Should have known right there things were gonna go downhill. And I was like, all right, well, I'm going on vacation, got another week, so I'm not gonna be, pressed for the bike. However, a month or more from now, whenever that date would have been, that time frame, I'm moving. And I want to take my kid brother riding. And this is my dirt bike that doesn't fucking work right now. So if you would, fucking get her going for me. Yeah, man, no problem. Cool. Didn't happen. Or it barely happened. I fucking got it the weekend that I was supposed to be moving. Anyways, I rode that bike a lot. Did a big West Virginia trip on it. Did trails 172, 199, 197, whatever 180 something was. And had a good time on that bike. Learned a lot on that bike. But eventually my riding was trying to kind of outgrow that bike's capabilities or its specialty. That bike pulled hard and climbed good. I didn't do single track real well. I was starting to ride harder and nastier, more technical style single track. So I found a real good deal on a KTM 250 XCW. It was a 2012 or maybe a 2013 model. It was the last of that generation, whatever that would be, all you KTM guys. So, shit, my camera fell. My GoPro's falling. My GoPro's like not on. I don't know what's going on. Yeah, so anyways, Honda 450X. My GoPro was pointed down at the ground. I didn't realize that, so I had to fix her. But anyways, Honda 450X, sold it. Bought a KTM 250XCW because it was a real good deal. It was a 12, the shitty starter setup, like the older style. Oh, dang, going off the trail. Anyways, I bought that bike because it was too damn good of a deal to pass up. So I found this bike by chance. I was running a GP in Kentucky, and my good buddy Scott Johnson was there. Met him by chance. His girlfriend, fiance, wife to be, I don't know, very, very sweet lady, worked with one of my best friend's wives. They actually were in the same salon together, and my best friend's wife has since purchased it from her. Woohoo! Go Beauty Solutions. Anyhow, I met him and he's like, man, you ought to buy my bike. You're looking for a 300. And that was this bike. We worked out a date to meet. The rest is history. It's by far been my favorite bike to date. And I'll tell you, before November last year when I got this thing, I would not have dreamed of being able or thinking about doing the shit that I can ride now. And I'm not the fucking fastest or best or, you know, most consistent rider out there by any means, but this bike and the type of riding we do are built for each other. This bike is much more capable, much more designed for the application of hard enduro. I love this fucking bike. That's why I bought a new 20 race edition. But as far as setup goes, this bike came pretty well protected. It had the Cycro wraparound, the handguards on it, had a Enduro Engineering skid plate, it had tubeless front and rear. Had a linkage guard. What else did she have on her? I went and put a pipe guard on it. Shout out to P3, based out of my hometown now, Hurricane, West Virginia. Went and got a in person, met the dudes behind the closed doors. Got a buddy deal, Cash, and bought me and my friend Bobby, who I got my race edition from, both one. Very solid product, very happy with those. Still running them 200 hours later on this bike, and shit, his is still pretty much like new. Need to cut these stupid zip ties. Keep getting me hung up. Chin piece. Controversial topic is clutch. I do run a Recluse CX Radius clutch. Scott had that clutch on this bike when I bought it. Swore to everybody that would be the first adjustment I made, was taking this thing off and, ouch, putting the old stock clutch back on. But I'll be honest with you, I went and rode it a few times and I freaking liked it. So I kept it. It's gonna be bad, bro. This hill is not that bad unless it's slick, and then it's really, really bad. Fuck yes, son. Fuck yeah, Dano. Come on, Dane. Come on, Dane. Come on, baby. Get that motherfucker. Get that motherfucker. Come on, he's got it. Come on. Inch it, baby. Inchworm that bitch. Fuck yeah, bud. Dude, this hill's not even bad until it's wet, and then it's bad. All these little skinny punks can fucking fly through here. My shoulders are so fucking wide and my ass is so fat, I can barely even fucking duck fit through this shit. These little skinny bastards, they're standing up just fucking letting her eat and rip. And not me, buddy. Oh shit. But anyways, what I'm trying to say is these bikes are awesome. And while I'm gonna definitely pull for Beta, I think any of them are good. KTMs are good, Sherco's are good, Betas are good, Huskies are good, they're all good. It just depends on what you like, how they fit you. You know, we all wear different size shirts, different size pants and boots. Bikes are kind of the same way. They fit us differently. Personally, I like the way the Beta fits me. My little skinny shit buddy Stone didn't really like the way the Beta fit him, so he went and got a orange Kool-Aid bike. Just came off of a blue Kool-Aid bike. He'll probably be on a red Kool-Aid bike next. There's nothing wrong with that. Thank you. shit. Just about washed the front end out. Hey, he's daggone roots, man. Woo! I don't think there's a tire out there that does real, real good in these roots when they're frozen, wet, and as slick as they are today. So as far as the tire thing goes, Shinko Fatty front. Going forward, I'll be running the cheater compound. Reason being is, regular compound's great, but anyone that's ran one can tell you, at about 50 hours, she's gonna start chunking some side knobbies. I ran the Golden Tire Fatty front, which I'm telling you right now, if it didn't say Golden Tire on it, it's exactly the same tread pattern and carcass of the Shinko, but the main difference is the compound. The Golden, definitely soft. The Shinko Standard's definitely pretty medium to harder. The Cheater is gonna be a softer gummy compound, so it should wear better like the Golden and not chunk as bad like the Standard. I don't even know how many hundred miles, a bunch of hours, I had on that Golden. Never chunked a single knob. It just wore down pretty significantly. And that's what they're supposed to do. Shit, if it's gonna hook up and get good traction and take a pounding out on the rocks and all the, gravel and freaking hard-packed roads that we did in Colorado getting from trail to trail sometimes, I got no complaints that she wore down. Especially with not chunking any knobbies. That's what I'm saying. I do as I plan, and plan as I do, probably still rock the 505 on this bike. It's a long lasting, well rounded tire for my body. I joke around with all my friends and say this is the best tire ever made, and they hate it. They hate this tire, but I'm big. I lower the pressure down. I got that big sidewall. She bites. Knobs do good enough for me. The first one of these I ran, I got 98 hours out of. The second Shinko 505 Cheater I ran, I had about 80 hours on. And the only reason I switched it is because I blew a tubeless inner bladder and I had a fresh one sitting on standby. Otherwise I would have still pushed that tire probably 20 hours. Probably put another 20 on her easy. But the race edition, we're gonna step our game up in our tire choice this year for my race that bike. Need to revalve the front suspension. Need to get a good back tire on it. And I would like to get a comfort seat The seat on that thing, nowhere near as comfortable as this one. And this is a Sea Concepts comfort seat for the oversized tank. Love this seat. So comfy. So comfy. Oh shit. It's got the shit all knocked out of me. Freaking low hanging branch. So, suspensions, Jared SR1. Jared Daniels has taken extremely good care of me over the years. The final product that his service delivers for me is phenomenal. I'd put him up against anybody. Let you try, tell you to try his expertise upon any other suspension brand or service individual out there. Man, it's tight. His customer service is top notch. God almighty. Get that shit out of here. It's gonna fucking hurt somebody. Just customer service is very good. Turnaround time is very good. His final product is very good. His consulting, questioning, answer, feedback, respond time, and just overall communication is really good. That's probably, you know, the first thing I noticed compared to who I used to go to. That was definitely the big difference for me. And that goes a long ways. Goes a long ways. Another shout out, get me all my beta OEM or beta specific parts, is Scott Groves up at All Sports Cycle. He is a little bit out of my preferred radius. He's actually located in Roanoke, Virginia. And I've got a beta shop in Denver, North Carolina. That's 10 minutes from my house. Got one in Greenville, South Carolina. That's about an hour from my house. And we got Scott up in Roanoke. That's a couple, 2.5, 3 hours from my house. And that's who I choose to do business with. So that should tell you how good he and Kylie and Austin. I'm not sure of the mechanic's name because I've not had to have any mechanic work really done there. I've done the majority of this stuff by myself. And then at 220 hours, Jared Daniels at SR1. Did a complete overhaul on this bike. Top end, water pump, seals, suspension, greased everything. Bottom end was still good. I've had buddies tell me they had 600 hours on their cranks and bearings and everything was still tight. Chugging right along, doing like it's supposed to. So, got no doubts that this bike will do the same. Probably more. This looks fun. Fucking A. This shit needs trimmed the fuck out, boys. Lost my footing. That was not a foot peg. Oh yeah, this is the original Sasquatch. Mm-hmm. Damn, dude, that thing fucked me just now. That little baby root. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hell yeah, baby. Much going on in a 5 foot space there. Good God. Full lock, turned my bars both ways twice. Jeez. Thank you. Pretty up here. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty through here to not be recording, and way too slick for me to possibly miss a super wipeout on my face. It is frozen solid ground back here. Yee. Wow, can't believe how slick this ground is right now. I was gonna talk some shit earlier and you know, do what I do best and ask these guys that are running spike tires why, but now that I've hit some of this ice, we've been riding in the mud and snow all day, and I don't know that spikes would have helped any, but damn it, they sure would right here, because this is freaking bad. This is stupid slick. Thing to do is just try to stay center on the bike.